In this video, we'll study about the carotid system which supplies the brain. The internal carotid artery, which is the terminal branch of the common carotid artery, it traverses the carotid canal at the base of the skull and enters the middle cranial fossa beside the dorsum cellae of the sphenoid bone. Here it runs forward. So it runs forward along the floor and the medial wall of the cavernous sinus. Then it turns upward on the medial side of the anterior clinoid process. So this is the anterior clinoid process. So it comes to the medial side of the anterior clinoid process. At this point, the artery pierces the dural roof of the cavernous sinus and also the arachnoid matter to enter the subarachnoid space. Now it turns backwards. So here it turns backwards and then upwards. It turns backwards and then upwards to come to lie lateral to the optic chiasma just underneath the anterior perforated substance of the brain. Here it terminates by dividing into two branches, a large middle cerebral artery. So this is the middle cerebral artery, and then you have the anterior cerebral artery. So this is the anterior cerebral artery. So the termination of the internal carotid artery by dividing into a middle cerebral artery and anterior cerebral artery. Now we'll see what is carotid siphon. The intracavernous and the supracavernous cores of the internal carotid artery forms a U-shaped bend, that is hairpin bend, with the convexity forward, which is called as carotid siphon. This siphon dampens the arterial pulsation to provide a more steady regular stream of blood flow to the brain. The carotid siphon is an important part of the cerebral angiogram to inspect for masses in the pituitary region, which will widen the curl in the artery. Next, we'll see the branches of the cerebral part of the internal carotid artery. So the first branch is the ophthalmic artery. The ophthalmic artery arises from the ventral convexity of the carotid siphon and enters the optic canal to reach the orbital cavity to supply the structures of the orbit, including the eyeball. The next branch is the posterior communicating artery. The posterior communicating artery arises close to the termination of the internal carotid artery. It runs backwards and anastomoses with the proximal part of the posterior cerebral artery. The next branch is the anterior choroidal artery. The anterior choroidal artery is a long, slender branch which arises just distal to the origin of the posterior communicating artery. It courses backward, above and along the optic tract to enter the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle through the choroid fissure to end in the choroid plexus. Due to its long subarachnoid course and relatively small lumen, the anterior choroid artery is more susceptible to thrombosis, and it is often referred to as artery of cerebral thrombosis. The next artery is the anterocerebral artery. It is one of the terminal branch which is smaller, and it runs forward and medially above the optic nerve to the commencement of the medial longitudinal cerebral fissure, where it comes very close to its fellow of the opposite side. This is a diagrammatic representation. So here you can see this is the internal carotid artery. From the internal carotid artery, you get the anterior choroidal artery, and this is the posterior communicating artery, which connects the internal carotid artery with the posterior cerebral artery. Next is the terminal branches. The terminal branches of the internal carotid artery are the anterior cerebral artery and the middle cerebral artery. The anterior cerebral artery is the smaller branch. It runs forward and medially above the optic nerve to the commencement of the median longitudinal cerebral fissure. So this is the median longitudinal cerebral fissure. So it goes to the median longitudinal cerebral fissure. Here it comes to lie in close approximation with the opposite side anterior cerebral artery. So both the anterior cerebral artery are united by the anterior communicating artery. The anterior cerebral artery, then it curves around the genu of the corpus callosum. So before it turns into the corpus callosum, here it supplies the medial part of the orbital surface of the frontal lobe. So this is the orbital surface. So it supplies the medial part of the orbital surface of the frontal lobe. So this is another diagrammatic picture to show the medial surface of the cerebrum. So this is the medial surface of the cerebrum. So here this is the anterior cerebral artery. The anterior cerebral artery, it then curves around the genu of the corpus callosum. So this is the genu of the corpus callosum. It curves around the genu of the corpus callosum. The branches given off distal to the anterior communicating artery supply the medial part of the orbital surface of the frontal lobe. The artery continues along the upper surface of the corpus callosum as a pericallosal artery. So this is the corpus callosum. So this is the upper surface of the corpus callosum. So this artery continues as the pericallosal artery. And this gives off a large branch that is called as callosal marginal artery. So this is calloso marginal artery, which runs in the cingulate sulcus and near the splenium of the corpus callosum. The pericallosal artery ends by anastomosing with the branches of the posterior cerebral artery. The arch course of the anterior cerebral artery around the genu of the corpus callosum makes it easy to identify the artery in the carotid angiogram. The next artery we'll see is the middle cerebral artery. So this is the middle cerebral artery. It is a larger terminal branch of the internal carotid artery. It appears to be the direct continuation of the internal carotid artery and carries about 30% of the carotid blood flow. The middle cerebral artery runs first laterally in the stem of the lateral sulcus and then turns backwards and upwards in the posterior ramus of the lateral sulcus. Here it divides into frontal, parietal and temporal branches, and they emerge from the lateral sulcus and runs towards the area of their supply. Next we'll see the clinical correlation. Clinically, the cerebral thrombosis most commonly affects the middle cerebral artery or its main branches because it is a direct continuation of the internal carotid artery.